By the way, I am wearing socks and sandals, though for medical reasons. Not that it would help if I weren't. One thing I guess I should point out, I do not believe that there was no historical Jesus. I don't have any definitive conclusions, and I don't know how anybody could. That's true about almost any historical question that any real historian, as opposed to a dogmatist or an apologist or whatever, knows that all historical judgments are probabilistic and they're tentative and provisional because new evidence might come up any time or a new way of looking at old data might come up, and you simply cannot play favorites. I think what you can do is to explore a particular paradigm, a particular conceptual model for making sense of most of the evidence in the most economical and natural way that you can. And on that basis, I think that the mythicist viewpoint is probably the most cogent, but I couch it that way. I was in a debate a couple of years ago in West Virginia where I tried to make that clear, and one of the two people I was debating, as sort of a tag team thing, was disappointed and said that I had misled them because I was supposed to be defending the notion that Jesus didn't exist. And I said, well, it's not a dogma. I don't defend it that way. And you'll hear what I do have to say. But I should also point out that if it is not a dogma, albeit a kind of a strange negative one, hallelujah, there was no Jesus. I mean, that's ridiculous. But I don't think it really is decisive in terms of Christianity. I think there could be a Christ myth Christianity in much the same way many forms of Buddhism don't require a historical Buddha, which is probably pretty good because I think he's a myth too. But I don't think it really has a thing to do with atheism. It's obvious, I suppose, that there could be a God even if there were no Jesus, and if there were a historical Jesus, there needn't have been a God. The two really just don't have anything to do with each other. And again, you know, you could say, well, Christianity would have to change quite a bit to accommodate the notion of no historical Jesus. Well, yeah, but it's changed before, and it wouldn't be fatal, in my opinion. Well, so much for that. What about the mythical origins of Jesus according to the framework that makes the most sense to me? It seems to me highly likely that the Jesus Christ figure of the Gospels belongs with other mythical saviors and heroes of the ancient world, including ancient Israel. I guess you must probably be familiar with the subject enough to know that there's been a long-standing claim by mythicists that there are many dying and rising God myths that are very similar in outline to the story of Jesus that you find throughout ancient Near Eastern mythology. Going back pretty darn far, there's Attis and Adonis, there is Baal, Tammuz, Osiris, and so forth, and they're all in the general neighborhood, and they all have the same basic plot outline. There are differences, as you would expect, because the claim of mythicism is not, as some would have it, that Christians got together like a bunch of writers on a network sitcom and said, well, gee, this, look at the ratings that Seinfeld gets, maybe we could repackage it as Friends or something like that. That's kind of a silly view, in my opinion. And the point of invoking the parallels is not to say, you see, this is where those darn Christians ripped this off from. That's absurd. The thing is, once you see the parallels, you begin to think, oh, I bet this is the kind of thing we're dealing with here. Now we see the category in which it belongs. And that leads to the central principle of historical criticism, namely the principle of analogy. And that is to admit first that we weren't there, and you know, for to see any old event, we don't know what happened, unless somebody invents a time machine. And of course, I hope nobody does, because that's going to be the end of everything if it happens. You know, you go back there and prevent somebody from blowing his nose, and the world as we know it is gone. You know, it's, but if that's the only way you could possibly find out for sure that some things happened, and that's unavailable. So what can you do? What can a historian do? Well, you can make probabilistic, provisional judgments, but let's stick with the probable. I wasn't there, I don't know what happened, so I can render a verdict of probable or improbable. Now, how am I gonna do that? Well, I have to ask, if the source I am reading, in this case, like the New Testament Gospels, what is this like? Is this like a historical recollection, or is it like a myth? I don't think that's too tough to decide. I like the stop me if you've heard this one before, I like the analogy of a guy that comes in after a hard day's work, and he plops himself down in the armchair and turns on the TV, doesn't know who was watching what when the set was on last, and so the first thing he sees is a giant reptile stomping Tokyo to splinters. What's his conclusion gonna be? Oh, CNN. No. It'll be the sci-fi channel or whatever it's called in these parts, or as I like to call it, the skiffy channel. And why is this? Well, I guess it's not impossible to imagine some giant reptile having slept away the ages somehow. I mean, it seems, you know, kind of unlikely. We don't know how it would occur, but it's not unimaginable. I guess it could have happened. But what are the chances? Does anybody have any real analogous experience? Do we have any reports of this by people that weren't drunk or insane or dreaming or something like that? Nah, we don't. But on the other hand, you probably would immediately say, yeah, it's science fiction, because this sure looks like a bunch of cheapo Toho Studios monster movies from the 60s, right? And which I devoutly watch. My daughter and I watched a whole mess of them back to back. Of all of them, the Gamera movies are the most hard to endure. Yeah, you would say by analogy, I wasn't there, I don't know, but by analogy, I gotta say that probably this is a science fiction movie, not a newscast. And in the same way, if you've got a story where somebody his birth is announced by an angel or a god, and then it comes about through some type of miraculous conception, if this person outwits all the elders and the scholars when he's only 12 or 13 years old, he proves his superiority to conventional methods of healing the sick, he teaches, he gains great acclaim, he does miracles and casts out demons, and is crowned king, whether literally or figuratively, then gets in trouble, and the people that acclaimed him now turn on him, and he dies, often in these stories, on a hilltop, and then no one knows quite where he was buried for sure, and he appears to followers before or after an ascension into heaven. Is that likely to be a historical account? I mean, again, I don't know that it didn't happen, but what reason is there to think so? You've got to think, well, there's so many of these other mythic and fictive heroes that why should I think this one really happened? I'm a big comic book nerd, and always have been for over 50 years, and it's to me as if somebody were to say, all right, you got your Captain Marvel, you got your Martian Manhunter, you got Thor. They're all myths, they're all made up, but Superman. Now, Superman really existed. Why? Why should we think that? You could go into questions. Do we have any eyewitness testimony from Lois Lane? Was there any coverage in the Daily Planet we can look up? But just on the face of it, I don't know if you'd even bother going that far. You'd say, okay, come on, you need medication. It's obvious that this Superman is simply one more comic book superhero. I think it kind of comes down to that, and then when you begin to deal with the astonishing apologetics arguments, if you want to do that, it's kind of fun. It's easy to show we don't have any authentic testimony from Lois or Jimmy or Perry or anybody like that in the case of Jesus. But I don't want to go in that direction yet. I just want to say that the judgment, provisional as it must be, that one would have to make is that the Jesus story is simply one more of the story of a dying and rising God. Well, myths are usually the scripts for rituals, and the dying and rising God myths certainly were. They seem to have begun as rituals for the new year, the change of seasons in various agricultural societies. And the notion was that you had to bring about the turn of the year and the revitalization of vegetation by reenacting the myth, which may have happened, who knows how long ago, or may have happened in heaven or something, but you have to reenact on earth the events in a dramatic form. This thinking survives some places that you wouldn't expect. Back, I guess, in the early part of the 20th century, one Greek mythology scholar was in Greece, and he was doing research to see how much of the ancient myth had survived as popular belief. And he went to a Good Friday service in one remote Greek farming village. And there, how these passion plays work, people are dressed up as the characters and so forth. They act out the passion narrative. Well, the guy dressed as Jesus is on a stretcher now, taken down from the cross, and they're bringing him into the tomb, and the guy's watching with interest, taking notes, and there's this little old lady next to him who's weeping and hysterically, and he says, "Ma'am, what's the matter?" And she said, "If Jesus doesn't rise on Sunday, we'll have no crops this year." That was the idea originally, and it doesn't die out. Well, this is pretty archaic. It goes way back there. But it survived on into New Testament times because these traditional societies got broken up as Hellenistic cosmopolitanism advanced, as people moved around the Mediterranean world in unprecedented numbers, some of them as prisoners of war, some of them as just traveling merchants, some as slaves sold from one place to the other, or some as missionary scouts for this religion and that. And as there were more and more people, let's say from Phrygia in modern Turkey, that found each other in Rome, they would set up the equivalent of something like a Slavonic Hall or a Black Students Union today. And the thing they would unite about, the only thing they had left living so far from home, was the old religion. In this case, the religion of Attis and Sibylle, one of the dying and rising God myths. And so that would be the focus. Now, this was divorced from its original agricultural setting in this Hellenistic urbanization. So it was reinterpreted as a rite of passage. All cultures seem to have had, and in a disguised form still have, rites of life passage from one major stage to another, and that's where rebirth and resurrection language often comes in ancient religions. You're reborn to a whole new life when you, like puberty being the big one, with the most rituals surrounding it, and these rituals punctuate your life, and the passage into young adulthood had, in most cultures, had always involved learning the hitherto esoteric secrets of sex, death, and the sacred. This stuff little kids are sort of shielded from, and so on, and that seemed to take on a new dimension in this Hellenistic urbanized setting as esoterica of an advanced sort. Now you could undergo a ritual recap of what the Savior did. Hercules killing the Nemean lion, well, you would put on a lion's mane, and or if it was Mithras who killed the cosmic bull to renew nature, you might have to be initiated by undergoing a bath of bull's blood. It's you can't help thinking of the familiar line, "Have you been washed in the blood, brother?" Well, that goes way, way back. Attis bled to death after castrating himself. There's a long story to that, but I won't bother you with it. Well, guess what Attis devotees did? They laid it on the altar, and so on down the line. So you entered into the saving action of the dying and rising God, and in that way you gained salvation. And Osiris, his brother Set, had set him up to be assassinated. He was the king of the gods. And then his wife Isis managed to find the corpse and anoint him with sacred oil that resurrected him, and he went on to rule the afterlife and was reincarnated on earth as his son Horus. Fascinating. These are all religions that the ancient Bible people knew. I mean, some of them are explicitly mentioned in the Bible. Ezekiel condemns women who were part of the cult of Tammuz, a dying and rising god, in Jerusalem itself. And maybe the most surprising thing is that there's some good reason, though again, it's, you know, you're dealing with fragments and you're putting them together like puzzle pieces and you don't have half the pieces, so, you know, it has to be tentative, but there's reason to believe that even the original notion of Jehovah or Yahweh, the Hebrew God, was that of a dying and rising God. It's very clear in the Old Testament, especially in the Psalms, but also Job and Isaiah and other places, that they embraced the royal ideology or mythology of all the surrounding monarchies, which understood the reigning king to be the representative on earth of the king of the gods, and to renew the king's mandate of heaven every year. They would have him and other costumed characters reenact the primordial battle between the young king of the gods and the chaos dragons. And in the myth, Marduk would defeat Tiamat and so forth, and from the carcass of the monster would create the world. And by this feat, he vindicated himself as worthy of taking the throne from the old god, Ea, and so forth. Well, it's very clear that the weird references in the Old Testament to Yahweh crushing the heads of Leviathan and cutting Rahab to pieces and then founding his throne on justice and righteousness and all that is simply another version of this with the names changed. Baal, this was central to his myth, and we know darn well that the Israelites are big fans of Baal, though the prophets didn't like it much. They must have known all about Osiris because Egypt ruled Palestine in the whole third millennium BCE. The story of Joseph is a kind of a rewriting of the Osiris myth. They certainly knew about Tammuz because Ezekiel mentions him, and others too are mentioned in the Bible, albeit glancingly, as you would expect. I think the Song of Solomon is a somewhat bowdlerized version of the liturgy of Ishtar and Tammuz. If you know what to look for, you start seeing a lot of odd things pop up. Well, the suggestion is that not only did Jehovah kill the dragons and secure his throne and create the earth all in one package, but as part of it, he had initially been slain by the dragon and then fought his way out from the belly of it, as Marduk did, and so that was part of it too. That was a component. And in one of the Psalms, you read, there are several enthronement Psalms where with the re-enthronement of the king, they would also celebrate God's enthronement at the dawn of time. And part of that seems to have been a chant where they would say, Yahweh lives, let the people rejoice. What would that mean? I suppose it could mean other things, but it sort of sounds like there's the missing piece. It's not missing anymore, and that Yahweh or Jehovah was already a dying and rising God. Did people remember that at the time of the origin of Christianity? Whenever that was, by the way. If there was no historical Jesus, then you can't give a start date. Right? If it was a gradual evolution of extant mythology, then it's like evolution. It's a gradual accumulation of mutations in the story. So what would be the origin point? I don't know. But at any rate, that's when you say that Jesus appeared. Margaret Barker, in a book called The Great Angel, A Study of Israel's Second God, argues very persuasively that these old beliefs in Israel and Judah never really died out, despite the attempt of the priests and prophets to reform the religion, to make it monotheistic and to get rid of some of these weirder to us and to them ideas. But that, as you'd expect, that the old views continued on among the people. They weren't going to, like a lot of traditionalist Catholics, they'd still go to Latin Mass. I don't care who said they shouldn't. They're still going to eat fish on Friday, even if somebody says you can't, and so on. Well, if my Aunt Ethel went to hell for eating fish on Friday, I'm going to avoid doing it. So it lingered on, and when you realize that the very name Jesus, Yehoshua, means Yahweh is salvation, and that in the Old Testament, occasionally Yahweh would appear in personal form, and the Bible editors change it to the angel, the messenger of Yahweh, or of Elohim, of God, you begin to wonder if that's what their Jewish Christians originally thought Jesus was, a kind of an avatar of Yahweh himself. And seen this way, you don't even have to posit some sort of radical disjunction between these early Middle Eastern myths and the Greek myths, as if that were much of a difference anyway. I mean, their myths and religions are so similar anyway, and they're, you know, one's right next door to the other. So I think that myth led up to the creation or the evolution of the Jesus character. To me, that makes the most sense of this. And of course, the immediate reaction is, wait a minute, what about the Gospels? Don't they depict a man who lived at the time of identifiable historical figures? Herod the Great and his son Herod the Not-So-Great, Herod Antipas, and all these people. Haven't they discovered the tomb of Caiaphas? Everybody knows there was a Pontius Pilate. Contemporary writers give adequate accounts of him and all that. Well, yeah, but then again, there are also stories that have Jesus crucified under the reign of Alexander Jannaeus, one of the Hasmonean kings, which would put his death about 100 years before the Pilate scenario. Irenaeus thought Jesus was crucified in the reign of Claudius Caesar, not Tiberius Caesar. And there are other little odd things. There seems to be a rival tradition that it was Herod Antipas who condemned Jesus, not Pontius Pilate. And I gotta wonder, would there be all this confusion over the dates and the circumstances if you were talking about a historical figure of very recent times? I don't know. It could be, but it just seems more likely to me that we have something very much like Herodotus's attempts to locate a historical Hercules. He said, well, now in this myth, he goes there and he meets this king, which would place him at so-and-so date. But, gee, you know, there's this other myth that would have him over here, and that wouldn't quite match. Oh, forget it. There's no way. He figured there had to be a historical Hercules. You know what they're always saying in the kind of cheap flicks I like to watch? Well, you know, behind these legends, there's always some fact. Not the case, right? But he figured, yeah, Asclepius, the healing god, there must have been an actual Asclepius. He's just like Marcus Welby or something. And then he got mythologized and so on. Now, there must have been a Thor. He was just like, what's the guy's name David Petraeus, or the guy in the original Saddam was anything. I just can't think of his name. I'm losing my memory. Yeah, Storm and Norman, right? That's all he was. And It's, and now scholars figure that's just fantasy. These guys couldn't give up the myths. They were smart enough to know they were myths, but they just had to hang on to some historicity. And I think that's the case with Jesus, and that the early church at one point figured that they needed to locate a historical Jesus in the recent past. Why? Well, institutional authority. There were loads of different types of Christianity, Gnostics, Jewish Christians, Zoroastrian Christians, on. And many of them claimed they got their doctrines by direct revelation from the heavenly Christ. Well, as Irenaeus said, that becomes a game of can you top this? I mean, there's no way to know if you say God told you this, he says God told him something else. So what they decided to do is, okay, we have bishops who were taught by guys who were taught by guys who were taught by Jesus who lived not too long ago. It had to be recent because you didn't want a very long chain. The logic of this apostolic succession is shake the hand that shook the hand, right? So you don't want to say, I mean, now they're stuck. They can't keep moving Jesus up. But that's probably why they had different estimates in the beginning as to when he lived. So I think that, there's no need to really take that as history, even though there are all these stories about Jesus, because if you look at him very closely, as many scholars have done, you find out that almost every gospel episode looks like a rewrite of some Old Testament episode from the Greek translation of the Old Testament current among the early Christians. Stories of Elijah, Elisha, David, Moses, Joshua, and so forth. I was really taken aback reading. I made it my business to find every book I could where scholars tried to show that this or that episode bore such a striking resemblance to an Old Testament passage was probably derived from it. And there were several of them. I was surprised. And I didn't find every case they made to be very compelling, but I did find pretty compelling cases for virtually every one of the stories that, maybe this guy's off the track somewhere, maybe he isn't really making a connection, but this guy does. And I thought, now, what if, once again, analogy, you gotta ask yourself, what's more likely, that Jesus miraculously multiplied the loaves and fish for thousands of people, or that, and that even if you believe there is a God who can work miracles, right? What's more likely, that Jesus did that, or that somebody rewrote a famous story of Elisha doing the same thing from the Bible? Right? Everybody knew about the Bible. Everybody knew about that story. So what's more likely, that the creator of the universe enabled this guy to do this stunt that's even hard to conceive? You know, what did he actually do? Stretch the bread like a sponge and cut it off? I mean, what's more likely, that happened, or that somebody just changed the name in a Bible story? So I think that you don't really have persuasive historical data even. So myth leads up to Jesus. Now, how does Jesus lead on to more myths? It's as if this character emerges from mythology, but then is overtaken by it again. Well, the story of the earthly Jesus continued to grow with new episodes, that some of which may be esoteric, but I'm sure you've heard of some of them, like Veronica's Veil, right? Veronica was a common Greek name. It's just another version of the name Bernice. It means she who carries away the victory, just like a successful athlete. But somebody didn't know that and said, I bet that comes from Verus icon, true image. And so we get the character of Veronica, who is in the crowd when Jesus is going to the cross, and she wipes his sweaty, bloody face with a towel as an act of mercy. And what do you know? Jesus' face, his image, is embedded in the towel. And so this is like the Shroud of Turin, another one of those things. So that's part of the... Jacques Derrida, in one of his essays, says he was surprised to note that Veronica's veil was not actually in the Gospels. It isn't, but it's the same stuff. How about the wandering Jew? Jesus, again, is on the way to Golgotha, and this guy in the crowd starts ridiculing him, and even slapping him in the face, and Jesus, not in in much of a forgiving mood, turns to him and says, "You will tarry until I come again." And now the poor guy is walking the earth, wanting to die, seeing all the travail of the human race, but he can't die until Jesus comes back. Obviously, a kind of a nasty allegory of non-Christian Jews, right? You can tell where this came from. And there are other ones too. But what I want to suggest is that in a couple of other less obvious but really genuine ways, Jesus went on to become yet another kind of a myth. Where'd they get the idea that Jesus was fully God and fully man? There were all kinds of ideas early on. Some people thought Jesus was a righteous man, a prophet, a rabbi, etc., and that he was so faithful to his mission that God saw fit to adopt him as his son. Of course, the ancient kings of Judah were called the Son of God. It didn't have to mean you were, you know, a divine incarnation or something. And so he raised him from the dead and gave him the throne of David at his right hand in heaven. Other people thought, no. Jesus was the incarnation of some heavenly being, an angel or an archon or whatever. He was only divine and didn't actually become incarnate. It just looked like it because, after all, flesh is sinful. He wouldn't lower himself to that. So sometimes we read in the Acts of John that the disciples would notice that walking along the shore, Jesus left no footprints in the sand, or that he walked a few inches off the ground, that he didn't eat in their company, and things that you saw said about angels in Old Testament stories. So they said he didn't really even die on the cross. And this goes on and on. Similar stories are told about the Buddha and about Ali, the adopted son of Muhammad. It's a kind of a common mythological theme that used to glorify these figures. These are like diametrically opposed, and there were other views in between. Well, huge debate happened in the 320s CE or AD, as you prefer, and they said, okay, we think that Jesus of Nazareth was the incarnation of the divine word, the Logos, by which God had created the world. You find that in Philo Judaeus, Alexandrian Jewish philosopher who must have had a big influence on the New Testament. And so he was the divine Logos in human form, but how divine was the Logos? Was he of the same nature as God the Father? Or was he a created being, a kind of archangel of a similar nature to God the Father? And this wasn't purely, you know, spinning your thumbs. There were implications for this in terms of the plan of salvation. Did Jesus have to become perfected through his sufferings, showing us the way to do it, so we have to be saved by our own efforts? Or was he simply God who came to give divinity to those who would believe in him, in which case, you know, salvation by grace? Well, huge debate. There were popular debates and arguments over this. We're even told that down at the waterfront, you would hear people engaged in Christological drinking songs. Boy, would I love to hear one of those. You know, you lift a few and sing, "Oh, he's not one with the Father." You know, I mean, that's what they did. It's amazing to imagine, but it was a real, you know, popular sport. So they had the Council of Nicaea, and they brought all these bishops who, with some genuine philosophical acumen, debated this. It sounds very strange to us, but I mentioned Philo. It was part and parcel of ancient philosophy. And so they came to the conclusion that Jesus was the incarnation of the fully divine word, and that's where the Trinity comes from, right? That, well, might as well say so of the Holy Spirit too, that there are different persons, but one divinity that they share. And then there were further debates. Well, now, how human was Jesus? Was it just like a flesh scuba suit with God inside? Or did he have real human emotions but not a real human spirit? And so they hammered this out over decades. And finally, I know this sounds like it's just how many angels can dance on the head of a pin, and I am sort of leading to that, but they thought it made some difference, and they did have genuinely philosophical debates over it, you know, whether it's important in the long run or not. But, and so they finally came up with what all so-called Orthodox mainstream Christians believe today, that Jesus was one person with two natures, entire and complete, human and divine, and that these natures were not mixed or confused, but remained distinct, and, though inseparable, etc. And all of this came out of these decades of debate. Well, I want to suggest that though this reminds me of something Comte said, that he thought idealistic philosophy was really just blurry mythology. That if you're talking about Platonic forms, that's really not that much different than Zeus and Hera, really. I mean, well, what are you actually talking about? Some sort of clouds in the sky of your brain. And so it seems to me that these guys, thinking that they were actually putting their finger on something that was true and real in an invisible world, as if Jesus was sitting up there on the throne clapping when Athanasius's proposal won. It's just obviously like a paper formula of agreement, like a negotiated treaty. And do you really think you have arrived at a true description of unseen realities? Well, I think it became like a Comtean myth in his sense. It seems abstract, but it's really just cloudy myth. And of course, the Jesus that resulted is not all that much like anybody's Jesus in the Bible. Well, a lot of people who consider themselves devout Christians have never heard of any of that. I once did a homework assignment in a class where, after explaining all these different Christologies, I asked the students to tell me which heresy, if any, they belonged to, because I was pretty sure they must have picked up some kind of Jesus concept someplace and that their church hadn't really taught them much. And sure enough, oh, I guess I'm a Docetist. I guess I'm a Monophysite. It's pretty interesting, sort of Christological apperception test. Well, the other way in which I think Jesus has become a myth that isn't very esoteric, that everybody knows about, is the piety of evangelical Christianity, the pietism that, as far as we know, originated only about a century after Martin Luther among the German pietists, the people that said, yeah, I guess I believe all that stuff about salvation by grace through faith and the Trinity and the two natures and so on. What's on TV? It was just, they believed it, but that was it. And Jacob Spener and Count Zinzendorf and various others said, that's not really Christianity. It is all true, but it's got to be true for you. You have to let it set your heart on fire, and you must accept Christ as your personal Savior. People think that's in the Bible. They even pass out copies of the Bible as if they were evangelistic tracts trying to get people to accept Jesus into their heart as their personal Savior. I don't see that anywhere in the Bible. Obviously not in the Old Testament, but I don't think anybody speaks that way anywhere in the New Testament. And so what they're really reducing Christianity to all over the world, in the most popular form of Christianity, is this relatively modern notion of have a little talk with Jesus. You know, this thing that, the speaker last night was saying, I know Jesus personally. Yeah, I'd love to hear somebody defend that. Are they a channeler? I mean, I don't mean to make fun of them, but what are they actually thinking happens? Are they hearing voices, or they just feel some whim and say that must be Jesus talking to me? I think it's, with a lot of evangelicalism, it's basically just sloganeering. It's passwords. When people say that the Bible is infallible, I'm not sure they even have much of a content for that, which you find out as soon as you bring up one of these otherwise unimportant things, like, is the mustard seed the smallest of all seeds? Well, no. And even a fundamentalist can say, well, yeah, but that doesn't really make any difference except that I'm stuck with this doctrine. What is inerrant about the Psalms or the Song of Solomon? That couldn't even be fallible, much less infallible. It's not that kind of thing. So I think this idea that Jesus walks with you and he talks with you and he shows up on vacation Bible school posters playing softball with little kids, I'm sure you've seen stuff like this, that is a modern, sentimentalized mythology of Jesus. I was surprised to learn that a 19th century, perhaps the greatest of the liberal Protestant theologians, Albrecht Ritschl, was already crusading in his writings against this. He believed you could discern the outlines of a historical Jesus. I won't get into what he thought they were, but if you're at all familiar with Adolf Harnack, one of his students, it was sort of a more liberal, socially relevant Jesus that a lot of people would like today. But it almost doesn't matter. Ritchell said, what do we mean by Jesus? And Ritchell was a Protestant theologian. He figured Jesus has to be the big thing for us. Well, who was Jesus? Well, the only one that gives us any control over the idea, that is any meaning to the idea, is the historical Jesus. He's already been distorted and embellished in the Gospels, but among Christians in our time, Ritchell said, they're really constructing their own Jesus through their subjective experiences. They think of Jesus as they've seen him in stained glass windows and so on, and all naively, all innocently, but they've created a kind of a cartoon character that's essentially an imaginary playmate. I really hate to ridicule these people, and I don't mean to, but I think that's a fair description. And he said, this is wrong for Christians to do because the Jesus they create will consume the only Jesus we know we've got, the historical Jesus. And soon it's not going to matter so much what Jesus actually said to disciples. It's going to matter more what your subjective conscience tells you in the name of Jesus. And where does that get us? And so, again, it had become a kind of myth, and I think Jesus as the personal savior of Christians is another myth. Now, you can find various other ones. Jesus has become a jock with a Fellowship of Christian Athletes posters. Jesus looks like a football player and so on. Or Bruce Barton, Jesus the businessman. I mean, it never ends. As Albert Schweitzer said, just about all the supposedly critical historians of the 19th century, oh yeah, we've got the real Jesus here. We've isolated the authentic evidence. You can easily tell they're just spinning it. They don't realize it, but they're just making Jesus into a ventriloquist dummy for whatever they think is important. That is certainly still going on. There are loads of historical Jesus books written by really capable scholars, Elizabeth Schussler Fiorenza, John Dominic Cross, and on, just dozens of them. But it's an embarrassment of riches. Jesus couldn't have been all those different entities, which means Jesus has been further mythologized, even in the very attempt to isolate the historical Jesus. And of course, I think that the whole idea of there being a historical Jesus is itself the big myth. So much for that. Questions or comments or mudslinging? What do you know? Here's the darn notes. Yeah, I don't think I left anything. Oh, I didn't mention Buddhist parallels to the Gospels, but what the heck, forget it. Yeah. So.